Welcome everybody to Deep Learning. So today we want to continue talking about the different loss and optimization, and we want to go ahead and talk a bit about more details of these interesting problems.
We have a search technique which is just local search, gradient descent, mm-hmm. to try to find a program that is running on these recurrent networks such that it can solve some interesting problems such as speech recognition or machine translation and something like that.
So let's talk first about the loss functions. So loss functions are generally used for different tasks, and for different tasks you'd have different loss functions. And the two most important ones that we are facing are regression and classification. So in classification, you want to estimate a discrete variable for every input. So this means that you want to essentially decide in this two-class problem here on the left, whether it's blue or red dots. So you need to model a decision boundary. In regression, the idea is that you want to model a function that explains your data. So you have some input function, let's say x2, and you want to predict x1 from it. So you compute a function that will produce the appropriate value of x1 for any given x2. Here in this example, you can see this is a line fit. So we talked about activation functions, last activation, softmax, cross-entropy loss, and somehow we combined them. And obviously, there's a difference between the last activation function in a network and the loss function. Because the last activation function is applied on the individual samples, xm of each of the batch, and it will also be present at training and testing time. So the last activation function will become part of the network and will remain there, produces the output or the prediction, and generally produces a vector
of the world in vector space. But I think this is very difficult for people to, normal people to understand. They would not know what the heck they're looking at.
Now, the loss function combines all m samples and labels, and in their combination, they produce a loss that describes how good the fit is. So it's only present during the training time, and this loss is generally a scalar value. You only need it during training time. Interestingly, many of those loss functions can be put in a probabilistic framework, and this leads us then to maximum likelihood estimation. And maximum likelihood estimation, just as a reminder, we then consider everything to be probabilistic. So we have a set of observations, capital X, that consists of the individual observations. Then we have the associated labels, so they also stem from some distribution, and the observations are then y1 to ym. And then, of course, we need a conditional probability density function that describes us somehow how y and x are in relation. In particular, we can compute the probability for y given some observation x. That will be then very useful if we want to decide for a specific class, for example. Now, we have to somehow model this data set. They are given from some distribution, so they are drawn for some distribution, and the joint probability for the given data set can then be produced as a product over the individual conditional probabilities. And of course, if they're independent and identically distributed, then you can simply write this up as a large product over the entire training data set. So you end up with this product over all m samples, where it's just a product of the conditionals. This is useful because then we can essentially determine the best parameters by maximizing the joint probability over the entire training data set, and we have to do it by evaluating this large product. Now, this large product has a couple of problems. In particular, if we have higher and lower values, then they may cancel out very quickly. So it may be interesting to transform the entire problem into log domain. And this is really interesting because the logarithm is a monotonous transformation and doesn't change the position of the maximum. So we can now use the log function and a negative sign and then flip the maximization into a minimization. And we can show that this is equivalent. Instead of looking at the likelihood function, we can look at the negative log likelihood function. And then our large product is suddenly a sum over all the observations times the negative logarithm of the conditional probabilities. Now we can look at the univariate Gaussian model. So now we are one dimensional again, and we can model this with a normal distribution, where we would then choose the output of our network as the expected value and the 1 over some variable beta as the standard deviation. If we do so, we can find the following formulation. We get square root of beta over square root of 2 pi times the exponential function to the power of beta minus the label minus the prediction to the power of 2 divided by 2. Okay, so let's go ahead and put this into our log likelihood function. And remember, this is really something you should know in the oral exam. Everybody needs to know the normal distribution, and everybody needs to be able to convert this kind of univariate Gaussian distribution into a loss function. If we do so, you will see that we can use the logarithm. It comes very handy because it allows us to split the product here. And then we also see that the logarithm cancels out of the exponential function, and then we simply get this beta over 2 times ym minus y hat m to the power of 2. We can simplify the first term further by applying the logarithm again and pulling out the square root. Then we see that the sum over the first two terms is not depending on m, so we can simply multiply by m in order to get rid of the sum and pull the sum to the last term. And now you can see that only the last part here actually depends on w. Everything else doesn't even contain w. So if we seek to optimize towards w, we can simply neglect the first two parts, and then we end up only with the part here on the right-hand side. And you see that if we now assume beta to be 1, we end up exactly with 1 over 2, and here the sum over the square roots of the differences, and this is nothing else than the L2 norm. If we would write it in a vector notation, you would end up with this here, and of course this would be equivalent to a multi-dimensional Gaussian distribution with uniform variance. Okay, so, well, there's not just L2 losses, there's also L1 losses, so we can also replace those, and we will look at some properties of different L norms in a couple of videos as well. But it's generally a very nice approach, and it essentially corresponds to minimizing the expected misclassification probability. It may cause slow convergence because they don't penalize heavy misclassified probabilities, but they may be advantages in extreme label noise.
And that was my 1987 diploma thesis, which was all about that.
Now let's assume that we want to classify. Then our network would provide us with some probabilistic output P. And let's say we classify only into two classes, then we can model this as a Bernoulli distribution, where we have the classes 0 and 1. And of course, then the probability of the other class is simply 1 minus the probability, which then would give us the probability distribution p to the power of y times 1 minus p to the power of 1 minus y. Typically, we don't have only two classes. This means we need to generalize to the multinulli or categorial distribution. And here then y is typically modeled again one hot encoded. And we can then write down the categorical distribution as the product over all the classes of the probability for each class to the power of the ground truth label, which is here either 0 or 1. Let's look some example for a categorical distribution. And the example that we want to take here is a Bernoulli trial, a coin flip. And we encode head as 1, 0 and tail as 0, 1. Then we have an unfair coin, and this unfair coin prefers tails and has the probability of 0.7 for tails and 0.3 for head. And then we observe the true label 0,1. So it means we observe tails. Now we can use above equation and plug in simply those observations, which means we get 0.3 to the power of 0 and 0.7 to the power of 1. Something to the power of 0 always equals 1. Then 0.7 to the power of 1 is, of course, 0.7, which give us 0.7. And this then means that the probability to observe 0.1, which is tail, for our unfair coin is 70%. Okay, we can always use the softmax function within the network to convert everything into probabilities. And now we can look at how this would behave with our categorical distributed system. And here we simply replace our conditional with the categorical distribution. And this then gives us the following negative log likelihood function. And again, what we're doing here is of high relevance for all exams. So everybody should be able to explain how to come from a probabilistic assumption to the respective loss function using the categorical distribution. So here we again apply the negative log likelihood. We plug in the definition of the categorical distribution, which is simply the product over all our yk to the power of the ground truth label. Then this can be further simplified because the product can be converted into a sum by moving in the logarithm. And if we do so, you can see that the power of yk can actually be pulled in front of the logarithm, and we see that we exactly end up with cross entropy. Now, if we use the trick with the one-hot encoding again, you can see that we exactly end up with the cross entropy loss, where we have the sum over entire distribution times the logarithm of the output at exactly the position where our ground truth label was 1, and we neglect all the other terms in the sum over the classes. Interestingly, this can also be put in relation with the Kullback-Leibler divergence, KL divergence, a very common term that you find in many machine learning papers. Here you can see the definition. We essentially have an integral over the entire domain of x, and it's integrating the probability of x times the logarithm of p of x divided some q of x, and q of x is the reference distribution that you want to compare to. Now you can see that you can split the two into two parts using, again, the property of the logarithm. So we get the minus part on the right-hand side, and the minus part on the right-hand side is the cross entropy, and the left-hand side is simply the entropy. So we can see that if we have our training process, it is essentially identical to minimize our cross entropy. So if we choose the KL divergence, we can minimize the cross entropy. And so this is equal. And you should keep that in mind. This kind of relation appears very often in machine learning papers. So you will find it much more easier to understand them if you have these things in the back of your mind.
There's nothing more practical than a good theory.
Now, can we use cross entropy for regression? Well, yes, we can do that, of course, but you have to make sure that your predictions are going to be in the domain of 0.1 for all of your classes. And you can, for example, do this with a sigmoid activation function. Then you have to be careful because in regression, typically, you're no longer one-hot encoded. So this is something that you have to deal with. And what we've seen before, then this is equivalent to minimizing the KL divergence. Let's summarize what we've seen so far. So L2 loss is typically used for regression. Cross entropy loss is typically used for classification, typically in combination with one-hot encoding. Of course, you can derive them from ML estimators, from strict probabilistic assumptions. So what we're doing here is completely in line with probability theory. In the absence of more domain knowledge, these are our first choices. If you have additional domain knowledge, then of course it's a good idea to use it because you will build a better estimator. And they're intrinsically multivariate, so we are not just stuck with two-class problems. We can go to multidimensional regression and classification problems. No big deal.
Which is basically a vector space representation summing up the input from all sensors. That does not show any pictures.
Next time in deep learning, we want to go into some more details about loss functions. And in particular, we want to highlight the hinge loss, which is a very important loss function because it allows you to embed constraints. And we will see that there are also some relations to classical machine learning and pattern recognition, in particular the support vector machine. So I hope you enjoyed this video and looking forward to see you in the next one. Thank you very much.